everybody put your hands together like this and here, come on. Hey, we serve an awesome God today. We serve a mighty God today. Here we go. Say, Lion of Judah. Holy, and you're worthy of glory. That's why I lift your name.
you. There's some of you have been in such a low place for quite some time now. God said that some of you put yourself there. Well, hallelujah. And sometimes it's just life and just what we go through every day. But you've been in such a low place. And God said today that if you will call on my name, that I am the strong tower, that I'm going to bring you up from that low place. Now listen, hold on, don't get too excited yet, because God also told me to tell you that, you know, sometimes when you fall, Evangelist Kirkland, sometimes you fall and you get back up and you're still hurting. You still got pain in your knees and you got wounds and you got bruises. But God said that this time, y'all not hear me, I say he said that this time, that when he brings you up, you get up with all power. You get up with all your strength, and everything that the devil tried to steal from you is coming back. Double portion. So I'm telling you today, everybody, now rise. Morning, I dare about 10 people to run up here right now, and you're gonna get all your stuff back, because what the enemy thought he stole from you, oh, the devil is a lie today. I said the devil is a lie today, because the people of God are going to rise up from the low place today. The people of God are getting ready to rise up and get back everything the enemy trying to steal. You about to get your peace back, you about to get your joy back, you're gonna get your swag back too, Rosie. God is going to give everything you can to me. Where my intercessors at today? The people of God. The people of God got to rise up. Rise up. Rise up. You got to come out. Come out the place of depression. Say rise up. Rise up. Rise up. Rise up. You got to come out. You got to come out.
In the room today.
He's in the room today. We cry out to Jesus. We cry out to Jesus. Worship rise. We're going to warfare this morning. We're putting on the whole armor of God this morning. We're going to the enemy's camp. Devil, you are a liar. You ain't getting my children. You ain't getting my family. You ain't getting my business. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. Come on. Be lifted high. Be lifted high, Lord. Be lifted high, Lord. Be lifted high, Lord. Be lifted high, Lord. Oh. I just want just to sing a new song to the Lord. Oh. It could just be all. Oh. Jesus. Come on, let's call on his name. Jesus, there's still power there. There's still power there. Jesus. For the name of Jesus is lifted high. The name of Jesus is lifted
praying this morning.
Yes. We
joy that you forgot about, God has not forgotten about. Yeah.
We've been praying. We've been so.
That's it.
Now we're crying.
Sin. Some of you have been in dry places. You say, God, rain on me. Rain on me today. I need a fresh anointing. We've been praying.
We've
come on.
Praying.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now we're crying. Heaven. Sin.
Come on, lift your voice. Let me see you wave your hands in here today. Up. I was ready to give in, but I've been praying, I've been sowing some seed. God, I'm not moving. No, no, no.
We've been,
yeah.
Somebody
say,
send the rain.
Oh, I see God sending the rain. I feel the Holy Ghost in this place. Yeah, yeah.
We've been praying.
Children, I need prayer for my marriage. I need prayer for my mind. Oh, you've been praying.
We've been praying.
We've been so.
Yeah.
Now we're crying.
Send the rain.
Come on, we're gonna make it personal this time. Say, I've been praying. Point to yourself. I've been praying.
I've been praying. I've been sowing.
This morning, God is getting ready to rain on your houses, in your minds, and in your spirits. Yeah,
I've been praying.
I've been going. Now I'm crying.
Send the rain.
Come on, you gotta make it personal. Say, this is my blessing. This is for me today. This is what I'm gonna get. I've been praying. Say, you've been praying, you've been praying, you've been praying,
you've been praying.
That's it. Come on, we're making the devil real mad today. We're making the devil real mad today. Come on, you online.
You've been praying, you've been praying.
The person behind you and say, you've been praying, you've been praying, you've been praying,
you've been praying,
yeah. Come on, make it corporate. Come on, lift your hands and say,
we've been praying, we've been praying.
That's it.
Yeah,
God. Today. Say, we've been praying.
Oh, now we're crying. Heaven,
send the rain. Send the rain.
Send the rain.
Send the rain. Send the rain.
Yeah. Now we're crying.
Send the rain. Send the rain.
Send the rain.
I'm not moving. persuade you. You got to lift your hands and say, send the rain. Send the rain over my mind. Over my situation. Come on, send the rain. One more time. Last time. Send the rain. Send the rain, everybody. Send the rain, yeah. So I feel chains breaking in this place. Jesus, we're free in Jesus. Send the rain. Send the rain.
Send the rain.
Send the rain. Come on and lift your hands up to the Lord. Yay! How many free people do we have in here this morning? Yay! If it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, where would we be? Say, I'm free this morning. No more chains are holding me. No more chains are holding me. I'm free. I'm free. Woo! Look at your neighbor and say, I'm free. I'm free. Look at them like you mean it, honey. You're not in jail. You say, I'm free. Where the Spirit of the Lord is. Hey, got my back. Hey, where the Spirit of the Lord is, that is liberty. Hey, mama. You better be seated. In the presence of the Lord, when I come in the house of God, I don't come in here shucking and jiving, but I come to lift my hands. I come to shout for joy. You online guests, we love you. To our Hispanic family, Gloria a Dios. That means praise the Lord in Spanish. We love you. So anytime you come into the presence of the Lord, always lift your hands. The people that walking out there on the streets, that they wish they had your mind. Minds. But you're free. Say, somebody say, I'm free. And I'm never the same. Say, when I walk out of the building, I'm not going to be the same. Hallelujah. Well, we welcome you to the well, a place of refreshing, renewal, and restoration. God is in this place this morning. The presence of God is in this place. I'm so excited. We have our family here. We have my dad, my mom. Stand up. Had all our family. So y'all always see my mom, but y'all don't see my dad. Okay, he's got his hair permed and everything. He's looking good. Come on. Come on, my family. All my family. My sister-in-laws, pastor sisters are here. Come on, turn around. Give them a wave offering. All my family. Come on, stand up. Stand up. Nieces, nephews. Everybody's here. My family, Trina, Brian, everybody's here. Amen. We are so glad that you're here today. That's why my weave is halfway on today, because everybody was in the house. But it's good. It's all good. It's all good today. Amen. Well, we have some very exciting news happening here at the well. The first thing on June the 7th, 2nd, put this on your calendar. Pastor will be preaching at United Westland Church at Rocky River Road in Charlotte, North Carolina. One of his classmates, Antonio Wilder, is having his anniversary, and we want to go and rock that place, amen? So put that on your calendar. It's on the Facebook, so make sure you put it down so you can be in the place, amen? Well, we're going to ask Pastor Fontella to come and give us some exciting news that's happening here at the well.
Amen, Agape family. Thank you so much, Pastor Katiti. Well, today is Senior Appreciation Day. Amen. Amen. All of our seniors, wave your hands at me. Wave your hand. Ooh, y'all look good today. Well, we are going to celebrate you guys on today. Love on you. We are going to the front porch for dinner. Yay! We're going to give you some seed and just love on you. Anyone who wants to join, you may register at the table in the reservoir. That's going to be at 1:30 at the Front Porch Restaurant. Amen? Amen. Amen. Where are my graduates at? Adults and seniors. Graduating adults and seniors. Stand on your feet for me. If you are graduating this year or have graduated, woo! Give them a hand, guys. Well, we are going to celebrate you on June the 19th at Graduation Sunday. So you get to wear your cap and your gown, looking all cute with your heels. And come in here, and we're going to celebrate you guys. So make sure you sign the registration sheet in the reservoir, okay? Amen? Amen. Amen. The Summer 7 Series. How many of you guys are registered for the Summer 7 Series? Starting June. What y'all laughing at? Oh. Yeah, that's Ladera. That's Ladera right there. All right, if you have not registered for the Summer 7 Series, if you reach in the back of your seat, we have a card like this. We need you to go ahead and register today. Space is limited and it's getting filled up really quickly. So go ahead and register today. Make sure you drop this card off to an usher. Also, we have a table out front for you to register as well. And you can go to www.thewellrockhill.org and register also. Amen. And the final announcement, summer camp. Summer camp will be here at the Well this summer. We have Camp Flight coming back this summer. It's going to be from 6 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. The cost is $100. That includes everything, field trips, all your meals, breakfast, lunch, and snacks. Amen. Somebody say amen. Amen. Registration fee is only $75. And if you are a VIP partner at the Well, it's only $50 for all of your children. Amen. Amen. Agape family. Well, let's stand. We are going to meet and greet our friends and family. Amen. Take your selfies, post them on Instagram, and post them on our Facebook page.
Like, do this. How y'all like that techno? Yeah. You know how we like it in here. Well, welcome to the well. Those of you that are with us for the very first time, glad to have you guys here with us today. Glad to have you guys here with us today. All of our first-time guests, we have a reception immediately following the end of service. We'd love to hang out with you and fall on your neck and show you some love. So I'll give you some instructions a little bit later on in the service. We're going to take you to a private reception area. My wife and I and some of our pastoral staff want to come by and meet you, find out where you're from, show you some love. And not only that, but we have a parting gift for you. I can't tell you what it is. You're going to have to come to reception to actually get it. But trust me, you're going to enjoy it. You're going to like it. And you're going to thank me for it a little bit later on. Amen. You guys ready to get into the Word of God this morning? Touch your neighbor and tell them your life is going to be changed today. It's going to be changed today. It's going to be changed today. Why don't you open your Bibles, if you will, to 2 Samuel chapter 6. 2 Samuel chapter 6. While you guys are turning there, my 18-year-old, our firstborn, Asia. Is Asia in here? Or is she working in audio or someplace? Asia, where are you? All right. Well, she's in the back today. Stand up, Asia. Give everybody a little wave offering, dear. And nothing shy about her. I don't know why she like doing that. Nothing shy about her. She graduated yesterday. We're godly proud of her. Amen. Godly proud of her. Godly proud of her. We have many of our relatives in town. My father-in-law is here. He's a pastor also, so he's seldom able to get here. You know, my mother-in-law, she gets here as often as she can. Praise the Lord. Amen. We love having her here. She's like a second mom to me, and now I got a third mom and Pastor Joanne. We've got my sister-in-law in here. We've got her kids. We've got my brother-in-law, Junie. You've got my sister, both of my sisters, Felicia and Candace. Candace, I don't think they've seen Felicia. Felicia's the one that, you know, when the Spirit gets on her, she yells and shouts all over the place and breaks up the chairs. So y'all seen that. But you hadn't seen Candace. Y'all stand us, show, give them a little, that's my youngest sister, Candace. All right, and we've got my cousins here, Brianna and Trina and Brian. Y'all know Brian. He is the resident comedian in our family. A nut. A nut. All right, so glad to have you guys with us. I want to certainly show our appreciation to my family for making the drive to be here with us today. All right, now, with no further ado, let's get into the Word of God this morning. We're in a series, those of you that are with us for the very first time. You know what, one other thing. Continue to keep the Shabazz family in your prayers. You guys know we just did her son's homegoing service on Wednesday. It was phenomenal from my view. You guys know we don't do funerals here. We do celebrations. We impart the word, release the presence of God, and their families were refreshed and told me to tell you guys thank you for accommodating that experience this weekend. On Wednesday, and serving their family and feeding their family and loving on them through some of their darkest days. We do have, unfortunately, a terrible tragedy that hit our church just on Tuesday. The young man that was shot to death on Cherry Laurel Lane or something like that. He hadn't been here in a while, but he grew up in our children's church ministry. His mom is here, and she doesn't frequent the church. She works on Sunday, so she isn't able to frequent the church as much as she used to in the past. Was 20 years old, and he was lost to a senseless murder on Tuesday night. And so his service is going to be Monday over in Charlotte. So keep that family in your prayers, if you will. Isaiah Shin was his name. Some of you teenagers that are teenagers now or in your 20s, you might even remember him. Light-skinned fella with those cute Chinese-looking eyes, you know, just had a beautiful smile all the time. And his mom used to work in children's church pretty frequently. Some of you children's church staff might know Atanya, and some of you might know, I think she worked at City Financial for a good period of time, but keep her in your prayers. Obviously, she's taking that very, very, very hard, as any parent would, and so she can use our prayers. At the present moment, she just doesn't want to talk to too many people, and so, you know how we love on folk, we get in there and love you hard, but put your love in action, into prayers, amen, and let her feel those prayers before she's ready. She's just not ready to really talk to a lot of people at the present moment. All right, thank you guys for that. But let's go ahead and pick it back up and let's get into the series today. We're on a series entitled Buyer's Remorse, Buyer's Remorse, Buyer's Remorse. Something that all of us at some point in our lives have experienced. You know, whether it was the purchase of a car and it didn't work out as we had planned, whether it was a timeshare presentation. And you know, when you go to a timeshare presentation, you're going to buy. Come on, say amen. Then you're going to buy for the most part. You know, and then you got that payment. Come on, say amen. And, you know, and you start thinking, dang, what did I do? You know, that's buyer's remorse. Or you entered into a relationship with, you know, Mr. Tall, Dark, and Handsome. Come on, say amen. And then he wasn't everything that he cut out to be. He was tall, dark, and handsome, but he just won't work. Y'all quiet up in here. Or you entered into a relationship with, you know, Halle Berry. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And she was 36, 24, 36, but wouldn't cook. And so, you know, and so we enter into relationships, we enter into purchases, we do certain things in life that later on we actually regret. All right, and so the first part of the Buyer's Remorse series, you guys remember, for by way of review for everyone to bring you up to speed, we discussed Jacob and Esau and how Esau sold his birthright, you know, for a bowl of beans. You guys remember that? And we talked about impulsivity in terms of very often we find ourselves in buyer's remorseful situations because we make purchases or we make decisions or we enter into relationships out of impulse. You understand? And so it wasn't like his hunger was going to kill him. But he thought it was. He said, give me some of this. What is good is my birthright if I die anyway? And we know that a little hunger was not going to kill him. He should have shifted into fasting. Y'all ain't saying nothing until he was able to get him something to eat. And so nevertheless, we talked about that. You got to know when to hold him and when to what? When to walk away and when to. You better count your money when you. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. Amen. And so you got to know when to hold him and when to fold them. Part number two, we talked about reading the fine print. Once again, that was Jacob. Remember, Jacob had worked for Rachel, the wife that he wanted, for 7 years through his father-in-law Laban. Had got drunk one night during the celebration, wedding celebration, and he woke up the next morning looking at cross-eyed Leah. Come on, say amen. And then he gets up and he asks Laban, he said, why did you deceive me? Laban's answer was very, very important. And Laban said, because it is not our custom to give the younger daughter before we give the older one. Remember, we talked about sometimes we have buyer's remorse because we don't read the fine print. We don't ask the questions that need to be asked before we enter into certain things. Touch your neighbor and tell them, read the fine print. Come on. You know, the fine print tells you if you're 5 days late, we come get your car. And you walk out one day, come on, and you thought you had a 10-day grace period. You thought you can get a month behind, come on. And you come out after 5 days, your car shut off, or they already took it out. You're like, what happened? It's in the fine print right there in the contract. And just as you go into the contract of marriage, y'all quiet, you need to read the fine print. You need to ask that brother, have you been 90 days without consistent employment? Y'all quiet. Touch your neighbor and tell them that's fine print talk right there. You know, have you ever put your hands on somebody other than to caress them or pat them on the fanny? That's fine print talk. Pardon me, Bishop McCall, I'm sorry. I can get a little comment. But nevertheless, and you need to ask her sometimes. Y'all ain't saying nothing. How frequent are you? Y'all quiet up in here. You know, because men, we have a testosterone level that we want to be a little bit more active sometimes. You need to talk about it. Do you cook? Or do you microwave? Are you understanding what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? And so you need to ask those things. Do you keep the house? Come on, say amen. You know, and you need to ask him, do I have to bring home the bacon and fry it up into a pan? We need to have those types of discussions. Touch your neighbor and tell him, talk to me. That's the fine print. Last week we talked about how quickly we forget. How quickly we forget. 3 days after the children of Israel had left Egypt, they stop and they start needing some water. They're dying of thirst. 3 days after God has just opened up the sea, a big body of water, now they're wishing that they can go back to Egypt because they're thirsty. Only 3 days later, you understand, they have buyer's remorse. They got freedom. They got gold. They got jewels from the Egyptian. 3 days into the journey, they get thirsty, and they're mad at Aaron and Moses. And I was talking about on last week how folk would get mad at you when you can't quench their thirst. Y'all ain't saying nothing. You can't quench their thirst for attention. They'll get mad at you and leave your church. You can't quench their thirst, y'all ain't saying nothing, for affection or validation. They'll get mad at you and leave the relationship. You touch a neighbor and tell them, you got to get your own thirst quenched. You remember? We looked at it and said that God, that piece of wood that he threw into that bitter water, that piece of wood symbolized the cross, and that's the only thing that can quench your thirst, not a man, but Jesus. All right, now that's a review. That brings us up to today, part four of buyer's remorse. Y'all tracking with me? Buyer's remorse, once again, is defined as an emotional condition whereby a person feels anxiety, remorse, or regret after making a large purchase, questionable decision, or something of that sort. Now, if you will, 2 Samuel chapter 6, I'm going to read verses 3, 6, 7, 9 through 11. The place, have you started the time for me, James? Okay. The place, the ark of God, they placed the ark of God on a new cart and bought it from Abinadab's house, which was on a hill. Uzzah and Ahio, Abinadab's son, were guiding the cart. But when they arrived at the threshing floor of Nacon, your translation probably says Nashon. You know he was a brother, don't you? Nashon. You know there's somebody in the Bible called Chilion. Did y'all know that? Chilion. Just call me Chili for short. There's some brothers in the Bible. But when they arrived at the threshing floor of Nacon, the oxen stumbled and Uzzah reached out his hand and steadied the ark of God to stop him from falling over. Then the Lord's anger was kindled, the Lord's anger was aroused against Uzzah. I'm reading the New Living Translation. I'm stuck in my mind in the King James. That's why I think the King James said was kindled. My mind is stuck there. And God struck him dead because of this. So Uzzah died right there beside the ark of God, trying to do the right thing the wrong way. David was now afraid of the Lord, and he asked, how can I ever bring the ark of the Lord back into my care? So David decided not to move the ark of the Lord into the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom of Gath. The ark of the Lord remained there in Obed-Edom's house for 3 months, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and his entire household. Once again, David was now afraid of the Lord, and he asked, how can I ever bring the ark of the Lord back into my care? So David decided not to move the ark of the Lord into the city of David. Instead, he took it to the house of Obed-Edom of Gath. The ark of the Lord remained there in Obed-Edom's house for 3 months, and the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and his entire household. Now, we're talking about buyer's remorse. We've talked about the fine print. We've talked about a number of different things. This morning, we're going to talk about this. Write this down, if you will, a thought for today. Did you read the manual? Now, thank you. What occurred is a couple years ago, Charles Terry, 2002, we were living over in Charlotte. And we purchased this entertainment center. Nowadays, if you're modern, I don't mean to talk about your house and you don't have to sell it before you invite me over for dinner. But if you're modern now, we don't do entertainment centers anymore. You know, you get flat screens and you mount them to the wall. You just get a little, TV table or whatever and put it in there. We don't do entertainment centers, the big, massive entertainment centers anymore. That's kind of like, yesterday. So in 2002, when we did entertainment centers, I bought one on a Saturday. And I said, I'm going to put it together Saturday night. I wasn't pastoring at the time. And we were, leading worship at another church. We had to be there at 8 o'clock. So I started about, 10, 11 o'clock that night. It ain't going to take me long looking at this box. Looking at this box, Rev, I said, it ain't going to take me long. I can start about 10, 11 o'clock. I'll be good. And so, I open up the box and I look at the pieces. And I said, oh, I got this. I look at the manual. I don't need. This is simple. I'll just look at the picture. You know, because I'm smart like that. That's what I'm thinking. So I just look at the picture. And I can figure it out by the picture. And so I'm putting everything together. And all of a sudden, things can't. I pick it up, you know, you put it down, you work on it on the floor, then you lift it up. I lift it up, and the leg like this is leaning to the side. The top is on backwards. You know, and I'm thinking, dang, it took me 2 hours to put it together. Wrong. There's no worse thing in life than being successful at doing something you shouldn't be doing. Isn't that something to get to the end of our lives and we are very successful, we have accolades and we have plaques on our wall and we have degrees and we have all these things and people have given us accommodations and all of those things that God said, I ain't tell you to do that. That was not my plan for your life. You looked at a picture of somebody else. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing. You looked at a picture of somebody else's life and said, that's what I want. But that's not what the manufacturer designed. So I got a leaning entertainment center. At about, you know, about 12 o'clock in the morning. And so I said, dag, I got to put this thing all together again. I'll do it tomorrow. I ain't going to do it tomorrow like nothing to defeat me. Anybody else in here? Now I'm going to show that entertainment system. You're not going to beat me. You're not going to have me up all night and then I got to come in here after church and put it and break it down and put it. Now I'm just going to put it. So here I am almost finishing at about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. Now I've got the manual. There's a reason I have that little sticker up there that says L and R, left and right. You understand? I didn't think it meant a whole lot. You know, I just figured I'm going to look at it. Everything was backwards, all because I did not read. I figured that I'm going to make up my mind to do it on my own the way I think it needs to be done. Just bump the manufacturer. Just forget that he's got it all detailed. He's got it step by step. The man made it. You understand? He knows where everything goes. He knows how it's supposed to function. He knows in what sequence it needs to be done. But because I see a picture and I think I'm relatively wise and I think I'm relatively smart, I just do it on my own. Just forget, you know, that this manufacturer's going through the painstaking effort of putting all this paper together and putting these diagrams in order and putting the F here and the G here and telling you when you need a screwdriver and telling you when you need a flathead and telling you when you need an Allen wrench. But I'm just going to bypass all of that because I think I know the way that I need to do it. But the way that I think I want to do it is not the way that the manufacturer has designed. And when you're not doing it the way that the manufacturer has designed, you're going to end up at the end of your life or at the end of the night frustrated, mad at yourself, wasting time. Now watch this. So I should have been in the bed at 10 o'clock had I read the manual. But now I'm in the bed at 4 o'clock having lost rest because I didn't. Touch a neighbor, tell them, neighbor, if you read the manual, you can enter into God's rest sooner than you would. You're not pulling out your hair and pacing the floor and getting gray hairs and needing Xanax, come on, and a drink for you to go to sleep or a feel, y'all ain't saying, or a blunt for you to smoke to get yourself together or somebody to lay down with to make you feel good about yourself. Touch a neighbor, tell them, read the manual. Oh, I'm preaching better than y'all responding. I guess I must be ringing some doorbells in here. Somebody say, drop the plow, Pastor. You better say, stop the bus so you can get off because we're going somewhere this morning. Punch your neighbor, tell them, read the manual. Now, so we find ourselves in trouble very often because we don't read the manual. The way your life needs to be configured is the same way that entertainment needed to be configured, by a manual. And very often, just like that entertainment leg was out of place because I didn't read the manual. There's certain things in our lives that are out of place. Things in our marriage that are out of place. Things with our children that are out of place, on our job, out of place, in the church, out of place, because we simply won't read the manual. So now, David is the king of Israel. He's just been anointed king. David's first assignment as king is to bring the ark back. The ark is very powerful, and it's very important that we understand why he wanted the ark back. The Bible says that God had given Moses these descriptions of how he wanted the tabernacle in the wilderness built before he had a permanent place to worship. And so it was made of badger skin in certain places and purple and gold in certain places. And God gave him dimensions. And he said, where I want you to use the silver, and this is where I want you to use the gold. And this is what type of animal I want to be slain to be this part here. So then they had this box, is what some people call it, the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark of the Covenant had a lid on it. And the Bible says to enter into his gates. Come on, y'all ain't brand new here. Enter into his gates with and into his courts with. All right. So now it's kind of like a basketball court. If you want to understand the presence of God, I can kind of explain it in a very simple way to understand. The Bible says enter his gates with thanksgiving. Now, so if you go into a basketball game, football game, Bank of America, you know, Time Warner Arena, let's use Time Warner Arena for an example. You enter into the gates. So just to enter into the gates, you got to pay some type of price. Y'all quiet up in here. You got to pay some type of price just to get to the gate. Now, I'm not even talking about what seats you got. You might have nosebleed seats. You know what I'm saying? Now, I got seats over at the stadium. They're pretty good, but they're not on the field. You understand? I mean, they're pretty high up. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And when the rapture come, I won't have long to go. So they're pretty high up. But that was what I could afford. That was the price I was willing. If I want to pay a higher price, I can get closer to the action. Y'all ain't saying nothing. I can see the players on the field a lot closer. But that really depends on what type of price you're willing to pay. And so nevertheless, enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his what? Course. Let's go to Time Warner Arena. You get into the gates, you can have a seat. But anybody that has the best seat wants to be what? Courtside. So thanksgiving gets you into the gate. Praise gets you courtside. And see, when you're courtside, oh, you can see the grimaces on the players' faces. You can hear the coach calling out the plays. You can know when the defense is on, what they need to run play for offense. You can see the pimples and the freckles on their faces when you are what? Courtside. Well, whenever it came to worship in the temple, it was kind of like that. They had a brazen altar on the outside where they would slay the animals. They would take blood and they would put them. They talk about when you're praying and you're holding on to the horns of the altar. That's when they would take the blood. They would bleed the animals out. Then a portion of that blood they would give to the high priest. The high priest would go past the gates, past the courts, into a place called the holy place. The holy place was a little bit more close. That was like courtside. But after the courtside, you got the locker room. Now, you can have a bunch of people courtside, but only a few people going in the locker room. Y'all quiet up in here. Just the players, the very important people, the trainers. Not too many people are going into the locker room. The locker room is much smaller than the court. Now, and so what happens is he would go into the holy place. But even after the holy place, there was a place called the most holy place. The most holy, the holies of holy, as you were. It was divided by a curtain. I'm not going to go there today, but I can take you someplace. It was divided by a curtain. The Bible says that the high priest went into the holies of holies once a year to atone for the sins of the people. So he took that blood and he would bring it into the holies of holies, which contained the Ark of the Covenant that David is trying to get back. Are y'all tracking with me? And so the Ark of the Covenant, it had these on the lid, it had these two angels or seraphim that were bending down together. And they were, one was bending this way and one had wings coming this way, which symbolized the presence of God and the angels worshiping him. On the inside of that covenant were three things that are very important for us to understand, because that's what David wanted to get back. The Ark of the Covenant symbolizes it symbolizes so many things, but it's really the glory of God and the presence of God. Somebody say the presence of God. They have started treating the Ark of the Covenant like it was superstitious. And so they thought, well, we can't go anywhere or we would lose. And they thought it was in the chest. But it was not in the chest. It was in the God. And so they're treating it like a four-leaf clover. Y'all ain't saying nothing in here. You know how I used to go out to that little AME church, Baptist church. Come on, say amen. Had grass in the front, cinder block. Y'all ain't saying stained pews that'll get your shirt wet and rusty if you sweated in it. You know the pews that used to, y'all quiet. Y'all got nice chairs in here. When I grew up, we had pews that were wooden with nails on them. Rip your pants. Y'all ain't saying nothing. We didn't have a microphone system, neither we had the gas heat. Y'all quiet up in here. Anybody know what I'm talking about in here today? And so what ended up occurring, Rev, was this. He wanted the presence of God back. They started treating it. And you know at those churches, we would go out front and we would just find us a four-leaf clover and put the four-leaf clover on the inside of the Bible. Y'all quiet up in here. Like the Bible was not enough to give you favor, that you'd have to take luck and paint it on top of the Bible. Touch your neighbor and tell them, neighbor, quit that mess. That's superstitious. That's religion. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Now let me fast forward. And so what's on the inside of that Ark of the Covenant are three very important things. So you got the lid, which symbolizes where God sits in the holy place. You got the angels that are bowing down, the seraphim that are bowing down, worshiping him. Then the high priest will come and sprinkle blood on the mercy seat to atone for the sins of the people once a year. If he did not come out, they would tie these strings with bells on his ankle, because when he went in, if he didn't go in right, he wouldn't come out. He would die in that place. Why? Because God is so holy. He is so awesome. If he came in unclean, you would die in that place. And so if they ever stopped hearing the bells, they knew that the high priest wasn't right. He had died. And they're just going to take him by the rope and just drag him on out. You understand? Because nobody else could go in but once a year. So they say, you die. You're going to die in there. We're going to drag you out. Are you understanding? On the inside of that Ark of the Covenant were three things. The Bible says it was Aaron's rod that budded. Somebody say promotion. That symbolized a promotion. That's how they determined who was going to be the next leader when Aaron's rod budded. That symbolized promotion. The next thing on the inside of that were the tablets of stone. When David, when Moses went up in the Mount Sinai, he got the law of God. We call it the tablets of stone, but really it's the testimony of the revelation of God, what God's revealed will is. And so the tablets of stone would symbolize the principles. So on the inside of that ark, you've got promotion on the inside of it. You've got the principles or the law-giving revelation so that you're never dark in any situation. And the last thing that you had on the inside of that ark was a bowl of manna. Remember when they went over to the wilderness and they didn't have anything to eat? The Bible said they started complaining and God rained down manna from heaven. And they got up the next morning and they said, we don't know what this is. We'll call it manna. And how long could they eat it? For just one day. That's why Jesus said, you pray after this manna. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day. So in other words, give us that manna. And the Bible said he was that rock they drank of in the wilderness, and that manna that came down from heaven. And so that manna is a type of Christ. So on the inside of this ark, you got promotion. You got provision. That's what that manna is. And you got principles. And so David said right now, Israel is lacking promotion. It's lacking supernatural provision. And it is lacking the principles of God's word. We have to get it back. Are y'all following me? Now, that brings us to this point. David is the king. This is his first assignment as king. Very first assignment. Y'all know Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, Ted Cruz, Bernie Sanders, formerly Obama, Reagan, to make a difference. They start telling you when they're campaigning. On day one, I'm going to repeal this. On day one, I'm going to do this. David's assignment on day one was to get the Ark of the Covenant back. We're going to get the presence of God back. Because when we have the Ark of the Covenant, we have victory. We're tired of being defeated. That's what I'm going to do on day one. So David says, Abinadab, as you were, Uzzah, here's your assignment. I need you to do something very important for the kingdom of Israel. I'm going to assign you. I'm the king now. And this is the most important decision and the most important assignment you'll ever have in your life. We're going to charge you to bring the Ark of God back to Israel. Are you up for that assignment, Uzzah? So he tells Uzzah, come on, Uzzah. And then they go to Abinadab's house to get the Ark of the Covenant. And the Bible said they put it on a cart. Somebody say, and a cart was made of boards and some big wheels. Can I take about a moment and deal with that? The Ark of the Covenant symbolizes the presence of God. So they're trying to move God on some boards and big wheels. That's why a lot of denominations today are dying. Not all of them, but some of them. You know why? Because they don't want God to move the way he wants to move. Y'all quiet up in here. And it's not everyone. Oh, you understand? It's the same thing with some churches that are not denominational. You understand? They don't want to do it God's way. They want to make decisions based upon their boards and the big wheels on it. Y'all ain't saying nothing. And anytime you try to move God outside of what his word says, but making decisions with boards and big wheels, but what does the word of God say? What does the counsel of God say? What does the law on the inside of the cart say? Govern yourselves not by boards and big wheels and smart people with degrees, but what does God say? And there's nothing wrong with having a degree. I've got a degree, barely got it, but I've got a degree. But guess what? In this house, we're gonna move by the Spirit of the Lord. Touch a neighbor, tell a neighbor, move God the way he wants to be moved, not the way you want to move him. Okay, let me keep on them. I'm almost done. So David says, Uzzah, go down to Obed-Edom's house. And so they got it on boards and big wheels. And the Bible says when it got to Nashon's threshing floor, the ark began to shake. Uzzah did what most of us would have done that are conscientious, you know, responsible Christians. It's about to fall over, and Uzzah just went to steady. Isn't that what your Bible said? He went to steady it. In other words, let me stop what I think is important from falling on the ground, because I don't want the King David to be upset with me because I didn't fulfill my assignment. And the Bible says that when he touched it, he died. And they call the name of that place Perez Uzzah, or the breach of Uzzah till this day. And the Bible said when David heard about it, he was angry at God. And he said, God, why did you do this? What did we do wrong? So David said, I'm going to leave it and take it back to Abinadab's house until I figure out what I need to do to move it correctly. This is a strange thing. They were moving the ark where they wanted it to go wrong. Uzzah touched it and died. They take it back to Abinadab's house, but they're taking it back the same way they were taking it to Israel, and nobody died. It seemed to me, if I was David, I would have just left it where it was, because if Uzzah touched it and died, what's to say somebody won't touch it again and die? But God, somebody say mercy. God will always give us a second chance to get it right. Touch your neighbor and tell him he'll give you a second chance to get it right. He'll give you another opportunity to get it right. So he said, David, you're moving it wrong now. Now, if you keep trying to do it again, the same way I told you not to do it, and still trying to move it where you want to move it, I'm going to kill you. But if you take it back and put it back and start all over, y'all ain't saying nothing. Touch your neighbor and tell him sometime you need to start all over. You need to go back, come on. And you can't find out where you got off track. You need to find out why you got off track. See, if you're only trying to find out where you got off the mark, where you missed it, I hear people say all the time, I got to find out where I missed it. When you find out where you missed it, what does that change? When you get back to the same place, the same house, you need to find out why. Why do I always attract bad men? Oh, y'all quiet. Why do I always attract cheating women? Why do I resign from one bad job and go into another one that pays me nothing? Y'all ain't saying nothing to hear the guy. Why am I still unhealthy? Maybe it's because you're not eating right. You know, why do I communicate? What's going on in my family? Maybe we need to address how we're communicating with our children. See, it's not a matter of finding out where you got off wrong. It's a matter of finding out why. And see, when we start peeling the onion, anytime you peel an onion, it'll make you cry. And see, until we get to a point where we're going to say, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me that needs fixing, not my wife. It's me that needs fixing, not my husband. God, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit in me. It's time for me to stop pointing the finger and see all these fingers pointing back at me.
Touch your neighbor, tell them, neighbor, you in the predicament that you're in because of the choices that you made. Come on, just shame the devil and just tell the truth. We got to find out why.
Okay, y'all sit down, y'all sit down. Why can I not king friendships? Friendship, do I have a big mouth? Why does nobody trust me? It's because I'm a gossiper? Why does nobody want me in the house alone? It's because I walked out with some money the last time I left them there? We got to get back to the why. So David said, I know I need the presence. I know I need everything that the ark brings, but I don't know how to do it right. So what he did was he went back to the Levites and said, why did this happen? Now let's pick up from there. And I need about 10 more minutes, plus 5, to the second power. So David's first official assignment is an epic fail. His first assignment of king. Everybody looking up. This is our new leader. He's a worshiper. You know he wrote all the Psalms. Played the demons out of Saul before he was a king. So everybody knows he's skillful with God. Got this deep relationship with God. And you can't even move God where he needs to be. What's wrong with you, David? A worshiper don't know how to move God. Y'all quiet. That's how people are looking at you on your job. You got a fish on the back of your car. You got your little church. You got your little church emblem in your window. Y'all quiet up here. You got a cross around your neck. Come on. You got a Bible on your desk. You got all of this. And you got worship music playing through your PC on your job. And then a problem comes and you're unable to move God to fix it. And people are on your job are looking at you. I thought you were a worshiper. You ought to be able to move God. I thought you were a prayer. You ought to be able to fix this situation. I thought you had some type of power and position with God. I see you posting on Facebook on Sunday, but by Monday, you can't even trust God to meet your need. Y'all quiet up in here. How in the world can you jump, shout, scream, holler, knock over pews, beat people in the face with your praise on Sunday, but then you can't move God on Monday? Touch your neighbor and tell them, read the manual. All right. So David said, I've got buyer's remorse. I wanted to get the ark back. Now I've got second thought. Let me take it back to Obed-Edom's house. So he goes back and said, no, I got to figure out what happened. He reads the manual. And he tells the Levites, because you, this is 1 Chronicles 15. He said, because you Levites did not carry the ark the first time, the anger of the Lord our God, so he had the wrong people trying to move God. Touch your neighbor and tell him, I know you know a couple scriptures, but you better watch it whenever it comes to trying to move God. I know somebody done told you, you know, you called to preach, and that's all good and dandy, but you better get in your manual before you launch out on it. Y'all quiet up in here. He said, because you Levites did not carry the ark the first time, the anger of the Lord, our God, burst out against us. We failed to ask God how to move it properly. Have we been trying to do things on our own and watch this and say God is moving, or are we moving ourselves and God is silent? He said, we failed to ask you how to do it properly. God is a God of order. He said, then the Levites carried the ark of God on their shoulders with the carrying poles, just as the Lord had instructed Moses. Now, touch a neighbor and tell them, if you're going to change the fruit, you got to get to the root. If you're going to change the fruit, you got to get to the root. Are you understanding? You got to peel that onion, and peeling the onion will make you cry. And whenever you start looking into your past and looking into your history, and you start figuring out why I react the way that I react, why somebody dropped you, it's kind of like Mephibosheth. You remember when Mephibosheth, that was a son of Jonathan, and the Bible said that he had been dropped whenever he was a baby. And by this time, David, the king of Israel, sends a summons, and he sends to Saul's house and says, is there anybody left in Saul's house? house that I can show some favor to. And they said there's a guy by the name of Mephibosheth who couldn't walk. He was lame. And whenever they came to get him, he said, I'm nothing but a dog. I'm nothing. I'm not even worthy to sit at the king's table. See, that's how sometimes when people have dropped us in life, y'all ain't saying nothing. And we're going nowhere fast. And it seems like we're lame in the spirit. We can't walk by faith and not by sight. We don't even feel worthy to be at the king's table. We don't even feel worthy of a promotion. So we'll take any kind of job. We'll marry any kind of person. Y'all ain't saying nothing. But if you lay down with dogs, you're going to get fleas at some point. You got to recognize that there's a queen on the inside of you. There's a king on the inside of you. Boy, don't you let your past, whoever dropped you, whoever abandoned you, didn't live up to what they were supposed to live up, shape your future. Touch your neighbor, tell them, neighbor, you got to read the manual. What does the manual say about you? It says you're the head and not the tail. What does the manual say about you? It says I'm above only and not beneath. I'm a lender and not a borrower. I'm blessed in the city. I'm blessed in the field. I'm blessed when I come. I'm blessed when I go. No matter who dropped me, you can't stop me. Because if God be for me, he's more than the world against me. Somebody shout, read the manual. Okay, y'all sit down. Give me just a couple more minutes. Mephibosheth says, I'm just a dog and you've been invited to the king's table to eat. Wow. He's not concerned about who you are, how you feel about yourself. He says, you're qualified because of a covenant and a promise that I made. So he reads the manual and finds out the proper way that the ark of God is supposed to be moved. So then the Bible says this, he heard that Obed-Edom's house was blessed. When the ark went to Obed-Edom's house, the scripture says that it stayed there for 90 days. And the Bible said, and as long as that ark was in Obed-Edom's house, he was blessed and his household was blessed. Yes. Touch a neighbor and tell him, when you blessed, what's on you gets on your family. It gets on your neighbors. Touch a neighbor and tell him, that's the type of blessing I'm talking about. I want to be so blessed that the one that hates me on my job start wondering how stuff start happening for them. It's because, yeah, I know you hating on me, but you're sitting right beside me. And because you're sitting beside me, what's on me is going to get on you. Touch your neighbor, tell them, neighbor, that's the next level blessing that I want. Okay, y'all preaching me too fast and too hard. Okay. So he said, as long as y'all sit on the, he said, as long as it was in Obed-Edom's house, Obed-Edom and his whole household was blessed. Touch your neighbor and tell him, that's coming to this house too. That's coming to you. Tell him to tell your neighbor, it's coming to your house too. It's coming to your house. I'm prophesying and decreeing it. Why? Because you realize the mistake that you made and you figured out what you need to do next to get a change. You weren't so prideful that you just, I'm just going to keep on moving it the way I want to move it. I'm going to keep doing it the way I want to do it. No, God, I'm going to take a pause and see, how do you want me to do it? What do I need to do? Is there anybody say, God, I'm open, I'm willing, however you want it done, I'll do it. Whatever you want me to do, however you want me to do it, whatever you want me to give. Okay. So David said, so David found out how to do it. But then he heard that what helped him figure it out quickly was because Obed-Edom's house was being blessed and he is what? And so when he heard that Obed-Edom's house was being blessed, he said, we got to put this in overdrive. Bring me the Levites and let's figure out what it is. So you got to find out, whenever it comes to buyer's remorse, you got to figure out what's worth going after again. Are you understanding what I'm saying? See, some things that caused you pain before are still worth going after again. If it's going to bless you in your house, go after it. But some things you just got to leave. Some stuff ain't worth going after. Some folk ain't worth chasing after. If you can't return my phone call, y'all quiet up in here. If you can only come to me and borrow money, but I can't come and borrow none from you. If I always got to listen to your sad story, but you won't never call me and listen to mine. If I always got to keep your kids, but when I want to go out and you ain't got, you got something to do. Touch a neighbor and tell them, you need to leave that. But if you can find a cause
that caused you some pain, but you find out, oh, there's a blessing in that. You better press through your pain and get to your blessing. And David said, I don't care what it costs me. Obed ain't gonna be the only one getting blessed. Is there anybody here say, Pastor ain't gonna be the only one that's getting blessed? Is there anybody say, Katina is not gonna be the only one that's getting blessed? I'm gonna get my manual and figure out what do I need to do to be blessed.
Okay. God, I feel the Holy Ghost in me. God, I feel. Okay. I think I'm gonna expedite. I think I'm gonna expedite things. Now, are y'all ready to go? Oh, I feel like getting back to Costa here. Can I preach for about 5 more minutes? And I'm going to get you out of here early. Next thing that happened, Rev, he said, go down to Obed's Edom house. Oh, I feel like preaching. Good God, I feel the Holy Ghost. And he said, go down to Obed's Edom house. Because he's not going to be the only one in Israel blessed. Touch your neighbor, tell him, neighbor, God is no respecter of persons. Can I tell you what the old folk used to say? Some of the mature saints, they said there is no secret to what God can do. What he did for others, he'll do the same for you. If he blessed Maurice, he'll bless you too. If he blessed Angela with a husband, with 2 kids on her own, he'll bless you with 1 too. Y'all quiet up in here today. And so you got to figure out what in your life is worth going after. Touch your neighbor, tell them, neighbor. But this is the next thing that happened. The Bible said when they got the ark, they put it on the shoulders of the Levites. They started carrying it properly. And the scripture says this right here. Every 6 steps, they begin to sacrifice and to give God a praise. So you got to make up in your mind that I'm going to celebrate right after the mistake. Is there anybody in here that's not gonna wallow and continue to worry? Yes, I missed it, but that season is over. I had a child out of wedlock. I can't turn back the hands of time. I was in a messed up marriage. Knew I shouldn't have married him, but now I'm out of it. Touch a neighbor, tell them sacrifice anyway. Every 6 steps, they begin to think on how good God is. Is there anybody in here that says I'ma celebrate the small successes? You ain't got to wait until you get it back all the way to Israel. Celebrate the small steps. I didn't drink no liquor in the last 5 days. Celebrate the small steps. I smoked the joint, but I used to smoke a pound. Celebrate the small steps. I only slept with 1 man this month. I used to have 2 or 3. Celebrate the small steps. Is there anybody that said, I don't have to wait until everything is perfect, but I must celebrate right after my mistake? Somebody shout. God, I feel the Holy Ghost in this room today. Woo! Somebody say, celebrate the small steps. Now, and we going home. So David said, this time, we ain't gonna mess up like the last time. I read the manual. I know what the book says about how I should handle things. And so he said, boys, this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna celebrate every 6 paces. One translation says they celebrated on the 6th step. Another translation says they celebrated every 6 steps. Now the question becomes to me, you know, I ponder those things that don't make sense. And so number one, why on the 6th pace? When 7 is the number of completion, why wouldn't they praise him on the 7th pace? Or why wouldn't they praise him on the eighth step? Because eight is the number of new beginnings. And this is going to be a new beginning for Israel. Why wouldn't they praise him on the eighth pace? Why wouldn't they praise him on the ninth place pace? Nine is the number of fruitfulness. So maybe Israel is birthing something. So we're going to praise him on the ninth pace. But they decided to praise him on the sixth pace. But why the sixth pace? Because six is the number of man, the number of flesh. So David's telling God, God, I'm going to praise you and celebrate you even when I'm in the flesh. You better understand that. God, in other words, let everything that have breath praise. You don't have to be perfect to praise. You don't have to be saved to praise him. You don't have to dot every I and cross every T to praise him. Even when you're in your flesh, still lift up a praise. Still lift up. Still say, God, I ain't got it all together, but you still good. Because I'm alive and your mercy endures forever. So I'm going to praise you. 3, 4, 5. Hey! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Hey! I know some of y'all say, I can't do that. Yes, you can. When you get out of bed, it's about 6 steps to your bathroom. Before you put a toothpaste on a toothbrush, you ought to thank him for just getting you up that morning. By the time you leave the bathroom and get into your first drawer, pull out your drawers, it's about 6 paces. Before you put on your underwear, you ought to stop and give him a praise. Cause my God, hands and feet that I can walk. By the time it's time for you to get your coffee halfway down the steps, you ought to stop and say, you gave me strength to go down the steps. Somebody say, celebrate the small steps. You ain't got to wait until you get your degree. Celebrate when you fill out your financial aid. You don't have to wait until they tell you you got the job. Celebrate 6 paces after you leave the interview. Go down the hall, go 6 steps. Hey, celebrate the small things. We got to go, we got to go. Now, we got to go. Somebody say, celebrate the small things. No, my husband ain't at church yet. But he asked me, what did the preacher preach about today? Touch your neighbor, tell him, celebrate the small things. So here comes David. One historian says from Abinadab's house to back to the city of David was about 6 miles. So they're celebrating. There was a whole bunch of blood on that trail. Because they killing animals and celebrating. It's a bloody trail. So David is dancing every time with them. Because he's going to show him, this is how we're going to do in this kingdom. Saul wasn't a worshiper, but David is. The kingdom has shifted. And so he comes in, and I'm ending. And he's praising God with all of his might. Because he got the presence back. Some of you don't know how that feels. When you ain't been able to hear from God in a long time. You've been praying and praying. It seemed like God, it seemed like the heavens are brass. Y'all quiet up and say, you've been praying and ain't got no answer. So you've been trying to hook and book and ain't no presence. You've been trying to do everything, but it feel like you 5 steps from the club. Well, touch a neighbor and tell them, if you 5 steps, you better praise them on 5 instead of 6. Or you better praise them before. But you don't know how it is to be dry and be lacking promotion, lacking provision, lacking the word of God and revelation and principles. David said, I got it back, ain't gonna slack up. And I'm ending. So he comes into Israel praising God. And the first person that starts bugging out was his wife. And she looks at him and said, oh, king, you just were also undone and defiled yourself before Israel. because he had danced out of his clothes. He was down to his underwear. And you know what he told him? Y'all better get ready to dance. Because y'all still got shirts and stuff on in here. And I want you to keep them on, mind you. I want you to keep them on. But he tells his wife, he said, you ain't seen nothing. He said, I'll become more undignified than this. In other words, David said, you keep fooling with me. I'll give God an Adam praise. I still got on my underwear, girl. He said, you better understand, you don't understand how good God has been to me. David started rehearsing in his mind. When a bear tried to come out of the woods, I grabbed him by his chin and whipped his hind in. You don't understand, it was your daddy that God chose, that he chose me to replace. You don't understand what God has done in my life. And when you don't know my story, don't judge my praise. Touch a neighbor, tell a neighbor, you keep fooling with me, I'll praise him on the third step. I'll praise him on the second step. I'll praise. That's just how good he's been. We got to go. Find out. What happened? Why it went wrong? And then you flip it on the devil. And you start celebrating the small successes. Don't wait till you got everything you own. Don't wait till your bank account is full. Praise him when you just stop bouncing checks. If you'll praise him because you didn't get a $36 entry on your bank statement this week, if you'll praise him, then you'll see God start increasing it. You'll see God start increasing them. I want you to think about that for the rest of this week. Wherever you're going, before you can even get in your job, by the time you hit that six-step pace, think about maybe I'll offer up God a praise right here. I don't know what might be awaiting me when I get into my job. So let me offer up some praise right now. Let me thank him for the small things. Let me thank him for the small things. No, I don't have the supervisor position yet. But let me thank him for the job I do. Let me, the small steps. Last year I wasn't even working. So let me celebrate the small steps. Everybody resting on your feet, if you will. We're going home. We're going home today. Touch your neighbor and tell them, celebrate the small steps, the small steps, the small successes. A marriage isn't where it wants to be right now, but at least we're talking again. At least we hadn't fussed in a few days. Praise him for that. The small steps, the small successes. If you're here today, you've never made Jesus your personal Lord and Savior, from the front of the room to the back. I don't care if you've been to this church 1,000 times. Come to church doesn't make you a Christian anymore than standing in the garage makes you a car. So maybe that's you in here today, that God has touched your heart. You want to carry the presence of God. Maybe that's you. In order to do that, you got to make him Lord. What does the manual say? The manual doesn't say that coming to church makes you saved. It's receiving Christ's sacrifice as payment for your sin. That's what the manual says. From the front of the room to the back, if you're here today, you said, that's me, I want to be born again. I want to know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm saved, I'm born again. I don't want to doubt it. I want a peace of God that can only come through receiving Christ as Lord and making sure that I'm eternally secure. If that's you, slip your hand in the air and say, that's me, Pastor, you're talking to. That's me. I want to be saved today. Is there one? That's right, darling. Look at that. She ain't take no time. You can face me, darling. Is there another person? Is there another person that says, that's me, I want Jesus today? I want Jesus. Want him to wash my sins, wash him away, wash him away. I want to be made new. Take my sins and wash them away, wash them away. I want to be brand new. Take my sins, wash them away, wash them away. I want to have my mind renewed. Take my sins and wash them away, wash them away. Come on down, darling. Anybody wants to be washed? The blood of the Lamb is here to wash you. He's here to wash you. He's here to wash you. I saw three people up here at this altar. We're waiting on one more. Waiting on one more. I got some barbecue chicken at home that I got to put in the oven. Come on quick now. Come on. One more, one more. Come on down here. I saw three people up here today. There she is. That's it. That's her. Hey, China. Stretch your hands towards heaven, if you will, as an act of your surrender. Now, I want to share something with you, very important. Please understand that and look at me as I tell you here. We all make mistakes. After you pray this prayer and receive the Lord or rededicate your life, guess what? You're still going to make some mistakes. I'm probably one of the only people in this church that never makes them. But I do have to deal with a lying spirit every now and then. It comes up on some Sunday mornings. Comes out of me like statements like that. We all make mistakes. Just because you make a mistake does not mean that you're not saved. All right? Being saved doesn't make you perfect. It makes you forgiven. You understand? The most perfect person outside of Christ will see hell. The most imperfect person in him will see heaven. It's the blood. Not what we do. But once the blood's applied, now we want to return that favor to God and love him and say, God, I want to honor you. We get in the manual to find out what we need to do so that we can move with God and in God. You understand this? All right. So pray this prayer with me. Dear God, I realize I've sinned, come short of your glory. But you said in your word, if I believe in my heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, I would be saved. I believe Jesus died for me, for all of my sins, my past, my present, and my future. I am forever saved. I am forever saved, no matter what I do. I receive him as Lord today. Change me. Fill me with your spirit. Give me power to live a life that pleases you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you, daughters. Welcome to the family of God, or welcome back. All right, this is what I want to share with you. You see this lovely young lady right here? If you don't mind, she's going to take you to a room, pray for you, you know, see if there are any concerns, any questions that she can answer. Not only that, we've got the incubator. She's going to give you a little handbook. It's going to help you start your walk off by answering questions. It's going to help you engage into the Word of God this week. We love you all. Get your handbag. If you got a handbag, get your handbag. Praise the Lord. Everybody ain't saved in here. All right. Get your handbag you need. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, look at what God has done. Come on and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. We're going to continue worshiping God. It is kingdom investment time. Shout yeah. Sit down if you will. Sit down you will. Get the best seed you can in your hand. Get the best seed that you can in your hand. Amen. Get the best seed that you can in your hand. We're going to give, oh my God, I'm really getting y'all out of here pretty early today. Y'all proud of Pastor? We had church, and I'm getting y'all out of here at a good hour. Before the restaurants get crowded. Somebody say, Pastor, do it every Sunday. Do it every Sunday. I'm trying. All right. Get the best seed that you can in your hand, and when you get it in your hand, rest on your feet. How do you spell million? That's right. Somebody say one day, someday, someday. Amen. Get the best seed you can in your hand. And when you get that seed in your hand, rest on your feet, a signification that you're ready to give, that you're ready to give. If you're giving online, if you're giving online right in here, you can give from your app. You can text it on your app, or you can give online. Go to thewellrockhill.org. If you're like me, I give every week electronically. It comes out automatic. Amen. I'm going to make sure that I stay in the parameters of God for blessing. There's no need in praying for rain if you don't have seed in the ground. Rain does you nothing but makes your life muddy if you have no seed in the ground. When you got seed in the ground and it rains, you can expect the harvest. Amen. So whenever you're ready to give, just rest on your feet. Amen. You guys hear me say it all the time. If your offering or your tithing, your giving does not move you, it will probably not move God. Amen. We don't give around here because we got to. We give around here because we get to. We get to participate in what God is doing. We get to experience God's favor as a result of obeying his word. Amen. When you get that seed, hold it up in the air and take about 15 seconds and water that seed. Water your seed, water your seed. Father, your word declares you give seed to the sower, you multiply the seed that is sown. You said you love a cheerful giver whose heart is in their giving. You said that we give, Father, it will be given unto us. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into our bosoms. You're not willing to abandon or do without a cheerful giver whose heart is in their giving. You love a hilarious giver. Therefore, Father, that's why we celebrate when we give. We don't give as a debt that we owe. We give as a seed that we sow, recognizing that we can pray for rain and experience the harvest. And so, Father, I thank you for blessing every person that is giving. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right. From the right, before we move up to our seniors, we love you. We celebrate you. We are celebrating them at the first front porch down in Chester today. Seniors, on behalf of my wife and I, we apologize. We are unable to make it with you all today. We got family in town. We're going to go and see them on the way out. Please do accept our apologies. Y'all know we love you. We made sure that y'all got a seed, though. Amen. And so enjoy yourselves, those of you that are going to celebrate with the seniors. Drive safely down to Chester. And love the seniors. We'll see you guys next weekend, and we love you. From the rear, face to right, and follow the instructions of the ushers. Hey, to all of our online guests this morning, thank you so much for tuning in to today. I pray that the word of God has blessed your life. I pray that you have been touched and your life has richly been blessed as a result of the word of God. My God, didn't God speak a mighty word to us this morning? I want you to celebrate all of the small steps, no matter where you are financially, no matter where you are relationally, no matter where you are in terms of your employment or your career. I'm believing that God is going to start budding in your life and showing you small things that he's working on your behalf. Why don't you sow that seed this morning? Be generous, for God loves a generous giver whose heart is in the ground. As I say before, you can't pray for rain and get nothing but mud unless you got seed in the ground to take root that's going to produce a harvest in your life. We thank you so much for always supporting us, praying for us, and we're praying for you. We'll see you Wednesday night.
You see?
bless your day. I bless your day in the city. I bless your coming and your going. Oops, I almost forgot something. We've got some very special people here today. First time guests, first time. You're with us for the very first time. Let me see you wave your hand. Wave your hand. Wave your hand if you're with us for the very first time. Oh, yeah, we got plenty of first time guests. This is what I need you guys to do. If you don't mind hanging out with us for just a few more minutes, my wife and I and some of the other staff would love to come back and celebrate you. If you don't mind, wherever aisle that you're closest to, the aisle to my right or the aisle to my left, file out of your seats. These lovely ladies here with the first time blackers there in the front and the rear are gonna take you to a private reception area, and we're gonna come back there and love on you in just a moment. So why don't you just scoot over and ask somebody to give you some room and file out of these aisles right here. We'll be back there in just a moment. Come on, let's celebrate our first time guests as they are leaving the room. All right. They're leaving the room right there. You can just follow this lovely lady right here. Come on, celebrate our first time guests. Amen. Hallelujah. You are blessing the city. You are blessing the field. Something incredible is going to happen for you this week. I declare and decree, and I pray that you experience no foolishness this week, that God will keep you from the drunk driver, that God will keep you out of the presence of fools and put you in the presence of influential people. May your influence grow. May the Spirit of God rest upon your life. May it rest upon your mind. May you experience peace that passes your understanding. May you sleep tonight like you've never slept before. May you have rest that is incredible. May God take away the sleeping pills, the need for the glass of wine before you go to bed. And may his presence surround you in a favor and encompass you as a shield. May your life change and be enriched this week. And may you experience and receive all of God's blessings. And may God's highest and best be yours. In Jesus' name, I declare you and release you in the blessing. Have a great week. See you Wednesday night.